pray. Would you join with me in prayer? Father, we come before you, Lord. We're just thankful that we get to be in your house. Lord, we come into this place not to hear from a man, not to hear from a woman, not to hear from the old or from the young. Lord, not to hear from the black, the white, the brown, or anything like that. Lord, we come into this place to hear from you. And we acknowledge today that it's Jesus that's the leader of this church. So Lord, in the name of Jesus, we ask today your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, to teach us and lead us and guide us and direct us in your word. Lord, I pray as we open up your word, Lord, I pray that it would be divine revelation and divine impartation by your Holy Spirit into each and every one of us with open hearts and open eyes and open ears to see, hear, and understand your word and your will for our lives. And Lord, we thank you that as we walk out of this place, God, we would walk out of this place encouraged, equipped, and blessed to be who you've called us to be. That is, to be your church, to shine your light for the gospel and for the glory of Jesus Christ to this lost and dying world. And Lord, we give you the praise, we give you the glory, Lord, we give you the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, together we said, amen. Amen. Well, I'll tell you, I had a really fun experience this morning. I wasn't here in the main services in San Bernardino campuses because I got invited down to the Rock Church of Coachella Valley, and I got to spend the Sunday morning with them, and I got to teach the word of God that God had given to me for the church. And so it was really just a privilege to be with one of our sister churches. Our launch is there in Coachella Valley, celebrating 10 years this June, our very first church launch out there in Coachella Valley. We've got a church in Coachella. We've got a sister church in Temecula. We've got a church there in Riverside. We've also got a sister church down there in San Diego. And what a privilege it was just to be a part of the family. Was anybody here on Wednesday night with Pastor Eddie? Pastor Eddie came. I mean, that guy's my hero. I mean, for me, I'm biased because I grew up with Pastor Eddie. He was my youth mentor. I mean, he was one of the people that literally formulated me and you know, loved me. I got my mom and my dad who are my primary principal mentors, and I'm so blessed for them. But on top of that, I was so blessed to have Eddie and Donna in my life. And so it was just a privilege to go there and just to see that and just a thriving and vibrant congregation. And it's just so neat to be connected to brothers and sisters. Even though you don't see them, you may not ever know them, you may not ever visit. But if you're ever down in Palm Springs, I tell you, you got to go visit down there on a weekend if you're visiting snowbirding or whatever it might be, or melting in the summer 125 degree heat. They're still there. So I tell you what, it's just so good. But I just wanted to bring a message today. I shared it this morning in Coachella, and I thought that, you know what, it's good for them, it's good for us. And as I was preparing, I just started thinking about it. You know, I wrote a couple of different messages. As a matter of fact, I wrote four different messages for this weekend, and I had a process of about 3 different weeks of writing these messages, and each one of them was just kind of like, okay, this one's not going to work, this one's not going to work, this one's not going to work, and this is not the right time. And yesterday, I got to play Mr. Mom. I love being with my babies, my little kids. I got Bjorn, who's 5 years old, and Emma, who's 3, and they are just the joy of my life. I tell you, they are just a privilege and an honor to be around. I'm a doting dad. I love my babies, but boy, a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old, they can wear on you quick. So we had that tea yesterday for the ladies, and Stacy, some of the things that she does here, she works in our finance department, but on top of that, she also helps with events and decorations and decor and coordinating and things like that. And then on top of that, she also moonlights as a realtor. And so she was gone from 8 o'clock in the morning yesterday till about 8 o'clock at night last night. And I had the kids all day, and I was trying to get ready to study. And, you know, on more than one occasion, I didn't do what I should have done as a dad. I really just kind of, if I could use any other word, I would just say I was inadequate. I was an inadequate dad. You know, I started thinking about it. I cried out to God, and I said, God, I can't do this, God. I feel inadequate. I feel inadequate in life. I mean, I think about my life. I think about even the very phrase and the very position that I'm in. I mean, here I am. I'm the executive pastor of one of the greatest churches, I believe, in America, one of the largest churches in California. And you know, on paper, I think everything's good. You know, 17 years old, I went to Rhema Bible Training Center, and I got the wisdom and the teaching of Kenneth Hagin and the faith teaching of the faith movement. I got to get that from 17 to 19 years old. I graduated. From 19 years old to 23 years old, I went to California Baptist University, got a degree, Bachelor's of Science in Business Administration with a concentration in management and a concentration minor in marketing. And on paper, that looks good. You know, from the very beginning of our young adults ministry 13 years ago to today, I've been involved in leadership of the young adults ministry. I've been a pastor of the young adults ministry for about 5 years, teaching pastor at the church for 3 years. I mean, on paper, everything seems really good, but I got to tell you, I am the most inadequate person for the position that I'm in. Because I went to school at 17 years old. I went back to look at my faith and Bible training notes. You know what they were? They were doodles from a 17-year-old. I followed my girlfriend, now at the time my wife, Stacy, to college. I barely made it through. I did the very least I absolutely could to get through college. You see, there are all sorts of different things that on paper might look good, but to me and in my own life, there's so many things that say why I'm inadequate. I look at my wife. This month, we're celebrating 10 years of marriage. And I think to myself, gosh, I'm not the husband I know I should be. I don't always treat her how I know I should. I'm not the father I know I should be to my kids. There's times when I know what I should be doing and I don't do it. I'm not the pastor I know I should be. I feel inadequate. I feel like I'm insufficient. And despite all of these inadequacies, despite all of these insufficiencies in life, despite all of the things that I've done in my life that I would say would have disqualified me from God ever using somebody like me, God still uses me. God still uses me. And you know, I think you're a lot like me. I think that when you look at your life, despite the stage, despite the season, despite the time of your life, you'll look at your life and you'll find that there are all sorts of inadequacies that you face. You'll never be that husband that you want to be to your wife. You'll never be that wife that you want to be to your husband. You'll never be that parent that you wanted to be to your kids. Maybe you're at that point now where your kids are gone and you've grown up and you look back and you think about all the inadequacies of what you could have or what you should have done that would have made it even better. And you think about all these inadequacies and you think about all these things that have disqualified you and you think about all these things that are check marks against you. You'll never be that boss or that employee or that business owner that you think you should be. You'll never be that friend that you should be to the people. And there's all sorts of different things that we look at and we say, I'm just never going to be able to make it. And on top of that, the already burdensome pressures that we have in life, on top of all that, now we have this wonderful thing we call a tool called social media. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Periscope, Snapchat, all these different avenues where everybody posts their highlight reels of life, and we look and we compare and we begin to look at their life and we look at our lives and we think, gosh, my life is so inadequate compared to that person. They're always traveling. They're always doing something. They're always seeing results. They're always successful. And then there's me. And there's all these inadequacies in life that we seem to face. In every area, in every aspect, in every age, we find inadequacies. Yet we try to do things on our own. We try to get past them, right? We have the motto. We have that MO, the modus operandi, that if it doesn't kill me, it'll only make me stronger, right? Like, so I just need to get strong. I just need to suck it up, take it on the chin, and these are my inadequacies, but I'm going to get through it, and I'm going to keep on trucking, and I'm going to do it. But then what happens? We fall short. We don't measure up. We can't make it. We can't do it. We can't seem to arrive when we need to arrive. We can't seem to do what we need to do when we need to do it. And we wonder and we begin to look at life and we begin to say, why do I even bother? Maybe the inadequacy that you're facing is you feel like you're inadequate in your relationship with Jesus Christ. That you're just not at the place that you think you ought to be. That you're just not the Christian that the person next to you is, and you want to be like that person. You say, there's just so many things in my life that I feel like that tell me I can't. Today I want to talk to you about the message, and I titled it, When You Can't, He Can. Amen. When you can't, He can. You see, the Bible is very, very versed in people with inadequacies. People who are inadequate to do the job, people who are disqualified, people who are not qualified in any way, form, or fashion to do anything for God. And I want to take you to a story of a man. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians in the 12th chapter. 2 Corinthians in the 12th chapter. I want to take you to a story of a man. The man's name is Paul. You might know him. The reason you might know him is that he wrote about 2/3 of the New Testament. We would look at Paul and we would say, man, Paul is a very qualified person. As a matter of fact, Paul even one time lists his qualifications. He says, are they Hebrews? So am I. I'm born of the stock of Benjamin, man. I'm like, are they trained? So am I. Man, I sat under the greatest teacher of them all. Have they faced affliction? So have I. I've gone through it. He talks about all those different things, all the different reasons why he should be a person that arrives and that is there. But yet in this story, in this place, in this season of Paul's life, Paul begins to talk about something and the Bible shares it with you and I so that we can live it, so that we could see it, that we could apply it, and that we could understand it, and we can see what God wants to do in our inadequacies, in the seasons and the times in life when it seems like we can't, like when we can't be that husband, when we can't be that wife, when we can't be that employee, when we can't be that Christian. What do we do? So Paul says in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, verse number 7, he says, and lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me. Was given to me. What a gift. A messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Paul says, listen, I have had a revelation. Before the systematic doctrine of Paul, the doctrine of Jesus was Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, Jesus ascended to heaven, and he's coming back. That was all they preached. That's all they knew. And then Paul had the revelation of grace, and Paul laid out this systematic doctrine of Jesus Christ and of grace. Paul had these divine revelations. Earlier he says, I know a man. I love how he says, I know a man. I don't even know it was me or not. I don't even know. But there was a man I knew. It was me. And I was taken up. Whether it was me or whether it was like me in the third person. And I was taken up and I was given these revelations. And so he says, because of everything that has been given to me, so that I would not be exalted above measure, so that I wouldn't get a big head, so that I wouldn't have arrogance, so that I wouldn't live in pride, so that I wouldn't believe my own propaganda and listen to my own stories. Paul says, a thorn in the flesh was given to me. Now, when we think of thorn in the flesh, we oftentimes think of a rose thorn. Or something spiky like stinging nettle, or a great illustration I think of a thorn in the flesh is literally a thorn in the flesh when you get a splinter, right? I mean, it's incredibly irritating, it's painful, you got to dig it out, you got to wait it out. But you see, when you look at the word that was used here for Paul, even though we translate this as thorn, Paul, the word that Paul's using here really, really translates more as a stake, a pointy stick. So Paul's not saying, I got a little irritating thorn in my finger. Paul's not saying, there was given to me a splinter that bugs me. Paul is saying, what was given to me was a pointed stick jabbing me in the side of my life. Think about how uncomfortable. Think about how terrible. Think about how what a frustration that is. And he says, a messenger of Satan sent to buffet me. You know, one of the things I like to do, I like to be outside, and oftentimes outside alongside of rivers, and maybe you've seen rivers or you've seen the rocks there at the ocean, and over the centuries, over the millennium, those rocks have come from the mountains and they've washed down in the rivers through flash floods and through a continual beating of the water, a buffeting of the water. Smashing and crashing against those rocks have taken all of the sharp edges off those rocks and made them smooth river rocks. Paul says a messenger of Satan was sent to beat me, to lash me, to grind against me, to wear me down. I've got this stick, this pointed stake jabbed in my side, and a messenger of Satan that is continually, again and again and again and again, buffeting me, beating me down, just so I wouldn't be exalted above measure. Talk about inadequacies. Talk about disqualifications. You see, Paul had a problem. Paul had something that was stopping his forward progress, and he wanted it gone in his life, just like our inadequacies, just like our shortcomings, just like the decisions that we've made that we regret. We want them gone. We want them removed, and we want them replaced by what God wants for us and what God would replace for that perfect and the right decision. So Paul says three times regarding this thing, three times he says, I pleaded with the Lord to remove it from me. He didn't just say, this is really irritating, Jesus, please take it. It's still there. Jesus, please take it. It's still there. Jesus, please take it. It says, I pleaded with God. You see, when you plead, it's like a begging. It's an urging. It's an unctioning. It's on his knees, on his face. God, please, I need you to take this from me. The inadequacies of our lives, the things that we deal with, the very fact that we can't, the very fact that we don't measure up, the very fact that we're never good enough, the very fact that we're never smart enough, the very fact that we're never successful enough, we say, God, please remove these inadequacies of our life and make us perfect. But you see, the answer that Jesus gave to Paul, and it's Jesus here, the Bible tells us it's words of Christ in red. The answer that Jesus gave to Paul shed so much light on Paul's situation. Many people believe that the thorn in the flesh could have been anxiety or depression from Paul's past history of his persecution from the church. Other people believe, and Paul talks about in Galatia, that he was held up for medical reasons and that he couldn't go. So people believe that Paul might have had a physical ailment, though other people believe that that wasn't the case. You see, Paul gives us an ambiguous thorn. And I believe that the Holy Spirit, as he divinely writes this message, he leaves Paul's specific issue, Paul's specific thorn, Paul's specific inadequacy. I believe he leaves it ambiguous so that we can take our thorns, so that we can take our issues, so that we can take our inadequacies, so that we can take our infirmities, and we can relate them to the very issue that Paul had right here. And so Paul pleads with Jesus, Lord, please take this. And the Lord answers and responds to him in verse number 9. And he says, and he said to me, Jesus said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Paul asks three times, take these insufficiencies away. And on the third time, he gets a bah-bah stamp, request denied. But he didn't just get a request denied. You see, Jesus came and he says, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. In your weakness, my power is made perfect. And Paul sees the light of day. Paul sees the answer. Paul sees the clarification in this issue. And as he writes it, he says, I understand now why I had this. And now I see why I need this. And now I see how I can live through this. Why? He says, I would rather boast in my infirmities. I would rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Says Paul says, listen, I got lots of reasons to brag. But Paul says, if there's any reason that I'm going to brag, if there's anything that I'm going to let the world know about, I'm going to let the world know about my infirmities. Why? Because that means that it's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's about the grace and the power of Jesus Christ on top of me, resting on me. I like to put it like this in 21st century terms. Paul says, I'm going to Instagram not my vacations, but my infirmities. I'm going to let the whole world know and see. If there's a reason for me to brag, it's all the things that I am not right with, all of my inadequacies. Why? So that people would see Jesus when they see me. And then he says in verse number 10, he says, there I'll boast in my infirmities, in my reproaches, in my needs, in my persecutions, in distress, for Christ's sake. Why? Because when I am weak, then I am strong. Then I am strong. You see, Paul reveals to us an idea. Paul shows to us a reality of our inadequacies in life, that the grace of God is the grace is not just the favor that saves us, but grace is also the power that sustains us. Yes, the Bible says that we are saved by faith through grace. God's unmerited favor. We did not deserve it. We did not earn it. We couldn't work hard enough for it. But despite how we were while we were still sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. The grace that saves us is not just the grace that saves us, but it is also the grace that sustains us. And you see, in life, there are going to be things in your life and my life that are going to scream at us our insufficiencies, our inadequacies, our regrets, our decisions, the reasons why we cannot do it, we cannot make it. Our life will be full of things we are inadequate in. You know, I love movies, and I'll tell you one thing about movies. Whenever Rocky is on, I am watching it. I love Rocky. And has anybody ever seen Rocky, the Rocky movies with Sylvester Stallone, right? I think back to Rocky number 4. Now, Rocky has already gone, and he's beaten Apollo, and he's the world champion. And then you remember Rocky number 3, he got arrogant, and he fought Mr. T, Clubber Lang, right? Clubber Lang comes, and he just beats the tar out of Rocky. Just lays it to him, waylays him. But at the end of Rocky 3, Rocky beats Clubber Lang again, and he takes the title, the world champion, and Rocky's back on top of the world, and everything's good. And then Rocky number 4 comes, and Ivan Drago, Dolph Lundgren, like the perfect specimen of a man, comes and he challenges Rocky out of the USSR, and he says, come to the USSR and I'll show you what a boxing match is. If you remember, Rocky's there and he's looking and they're weighing in, and Ivan Drago, right, he goes, I will break you, right? Rocky tries to hit his gloves and they don't even move. And I remember this scene in Rocky the fourth chapter, right? If you turn to the Gospel of Rocky, the fourth chapter. I remember the scene in Rocky 4 that he's about ready to ship out to Siberia. Apollo Creed's trainer has taken Rocky under his wing, and they're going old school. They're going back to their roots. And they're about to go to Siberia. Adrienne's standing at the top of the stairs of Rocky's house. And she's asking Rocky, why are you doing this, Rocky? You've got a son. This guy killed your friend in the ring. You've got money. You've got a title. What are you trying to prove? And you know, Rocky, Sylvester Stallone, I'm a fighter. I can't say no. I can't turn it down. It's just what I do. And if you remember the scene, Adrienne, she's standing there at the top of the stairs, and she screams out to Rocky, you can't win! And he leaves with his wife telling him he can't win. You see, I think life is a lot like that scene of Rocky. There are so many things that are telling you, you can't win. You can't do it. You'll never be the father you want to be. You'll never be the employer you want to be. You'll never be the Christian you want to be. You'll never be the friend you want to be. You can't win. But Paul says, there was a thorn in my flesh that was screaming out to me saying, you can't win. But Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you. And when you can't, he can. The Bible, I love the Bible. The Bible is a story. The Bible is a narrative. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it is a story of inadequate people. From the very get-go to the very end, it is full of unqualified, inadequate people that did something great for the kingdom of God. I mean, God calls Abraham, and Abraham says, what am I but dust and ashes to talk to God? God calls Moses, and Moses says, what'll I say? God calls Gideon, and Gideon hides in a wine press. God calls David, and David was the least of his family. God calls Hosea, he was married to a prostitute. God calls Peter, who was an unqualified, uneducated fisherman. God calls Paul, who was a terrorist, terrorizing the church. God brings Jesus, a carpenter. You see, the story from beginning to end is full of a bunch of inadequate people that lived and operated in the grace of God to sustain them through the inadequacies of life. Because when we can't, he can. When we can't, he can. The Bible tells us Paul had this great understanding, this great revelation. And you're there in 2 Corinthians. Put a marker because we'll come right back to that. But go with me to 1 Corinthians, and I'm going to put it up on the New Living Translation, but it reads almost the same in the New King James, which you're most likely reading. Paul has this revelation to the church of Corinth. You see, Corinth was the mighty Corinth. This is the church of Greece. This is the birthplace of philosophy, of Western thinking. I mean, this is where the greats came, like Plato and Aristotle. And they were high and mighty. They had a well-defined, educated system in which many of the languages of the world are defined and built upon their language itself. And here the mighty Corinth, Paul says to them, 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, verse number 26, Paul says, "Remember, brothers and sisters, that a few of you were wise in the world's eyes, or powerful, or wealthy when God called you. A few of you, most of you, were nothing." In the first century, about 100 AD, there was a critic. His job, his whole livelihood was the criticism of Christianity. The man's name was Celsus, not Celsius, Celsus. Celsus' criticism about Christianity was this. He said it like this. He said, "Christianity is for the weak-minded, for the woman, and for the slave." Sorry, ladies, this was a different time. Women didn't have any rights. Christianity, let me just summarize what he said. Christianity was for the inadequate. That was his principal argument about Christianity. We hear it today like this. "Well, oh, that whole religion, that whole church, that whole thing, that's just a crutch for you." Yep. Sure is. Because I'm not trying to play like I don't have any inadequacies in life. I'm not trying to play like I'm perfect. Man, I make a lot of mistakes. And you know what? If you want to call it a crutch, give me a crutch on both sides. You know what? Forget the crutch. I don't even want a crutch. Give me a wheelchair. Forget a wheelchair. Give me the power motor lift, the hover round where I can reach the top kitchen cabinet as well. Because if you want to call it a crutch, then call it whatever you want. I'm full of insufficiencies and I need Jesus. So Paul says, "Remember, there were very few of you in the church that were wise, that were strong, that were wealthy when God called you." Look what he says. Verse number 27. "Instead, God chose the things of this world, the things that this world considers foolish, in order to shame those that think they're wise." He says, "And he chose the things that are powerless to put to shame the things that are powerful. And God chose the things that were despised of the world." The things that were counted nothing at all. And he used them to bring to nothing that which the world considers important. As a result, no one can glory or boast in the presence of God. He says, "Listen, church, remember, all of you are insufficient. Remember, all of you are inadequate. And that God took the inadequate, God took the unqualified, God took the insufficient, and he made them to confound the wise things of this world." Why? So that we wouldn't look, like Paul said, "Lest I be exalted above measure," so that we wouldn't look to our own ability, but that we would look and we would see that it's God that works through us. Verse number 30, he says it like this: "God united you with Christ for our benefit. God made him," Jesus, "to be wisdom." He said, remember, he said, there weren't very many of you that were wise. You're not wise, but Jesus in you is. Yeah. Jesus made us right. None of you were wealthy, were righteous, but God made Jesus to be righteousness for us. I mean, he made him to be pure. You see, you were unclean and unworthy, but God made Jesusness to become pure and to be the purity for us. And we were holy. You and I were separated from God. Now God says, "No, I haven't had you separated. I have set you apart for my use." And he has made us holy. And therefore the scriptures say, if you want to boast, boast in the Lord. Because without Jesus, without the grace of God, where would we be? You see, God took you. Jesus Christ chose you. He chose me when we were nothing to make us something in him. Jesus chose you when you were nothing to make you something in him. And the miracle of all of this is that the very power of God that accomplishes all that God's will have dwells and resides on the inside of us, jars of clay. Think about it for a moment. God could have said, I want my power to be encapsulated in the strongest and the greatest and the mightiest mountain of all. I want my power and my glory to be encapsulated and built upon or built in the most beautiful, the most glorious vessel on earth, shrouded in gold and silver and diamonds and all of the precious stones that the world has to offer. But rather, God took the dirt of the earth and breathed life into it and said, I will put my spirit in this jar of clay. This inadequate jar full of chips and cracks. And in perfect paint jobs, no matter how much makeup we try to put on. Amen. And he says, I will live and dwell in this jar of clay. Because Jesus chose us when we were nothing to make us something in him. And so Jesus tells Paul, Paul, you're inadequate, but my grace will cover you. My power will cover you. So what do we do? What do we take away from this? Where do we go from here as you walk out of this place and you're faced with the inadequacies of your life every day and they continue to scream at you, you can't do it. Let humility bring God's grace to you. Let humility bring God's grace to you. See, Paul says, lest I be exalted above measure, I was given this. Lest I be exalted above measure. You know, humility has all sorts of definitions and all sorts of different ways to define it. Humility to me, I just want to simply put it like this. Humility is not relying on myself, but relying wholly on Jesus Christ. You see, nobody likes to lean and rely completely on somebody else. A couple of years ago when I was starting my wood shop in my garage, I bought this table saw. It weighs about 450 pounds, made out of cast iron, a beautiful piece of machinery. I bought it off of Craigslist, and the guy had a little bit of a disability that I bought it from. So when I went to pick it up in my truck, he said, listen, man, I can't help you pick it up. I said, I got this. My wife was there, and I loaded this 450-pound table saw into the back of my truck by myself. And I was looking at Stacy like, sup, girl? That's right. I worked out once. That's all I ever needed. And when I got home, I unloaded that 450-pound table saw all by myself. I was so proud. I was like, man, I'm just glistening. I mean, my muscles were shining. And I was like, I went into the mirror and I was like, is there nothing that I cannot do? A couple of months later, I went and bought another piece of machinery about half that weight, about 200 pounds. Made out of cast iron, same thing, a little bit smaller, a little bit more awkward. I picked it up, same thing. I loaded it in my truck all by myself because, I mean, if you can load a 450-pound table saw, you can load a 200-pound jointer, right? So I load this piece of equipment in my truck. I get home, and I'm unloading it out of my truck, and I'm like, I got this. I got it all by myself. And sure enough, what happens? I dropped it, and it fell over. The grace of God and the glory of God and his mercy that endureth forever saved my toes from being forever crushed. I would not be walking like I'm walking today. But there was, and it was awkward, it was weird, it was so top heavy that I'm there and I'm looking around like, did anybody see? Did anybody, you know, it's in my driveway, like, shake it off, I got this, you know, and I'm trying to pick it up and it's awkward. And so I pick it up and it flops over to the other side and I'm like, all right. So I got to go inside. And what do? I got to go ask Stacy, hey, babe, can you help me lift this? I dropped it. And she's like, why didn't you ask in the first place? Because I don't want to ask anybody for help. I want to be self-reliant. You see, humility. Humility is not relying on myself, but leaning wholly on Jesus Christ. Arrogance, I mean, think about it. Arrogance is the exact opposite of that. Arrogance is self-reliance. I don't need your words. I don't need your advice. I don't need your direction. I don't need your help. I already got everything I need. That's what arrogance says, right? I can do this by myself. Humility is surrendering and letting go of myself, saying, I can't do this and I only need Jesus. Let humility bring the grace of God to you. You see, Paul says it like this, lest I be exalted above measure. The thorn in the flesh was given to me. And he says, I pleaded and I begged with God three times. And Jesus' answer was this to Paul. My grace is sufficient. My power is made perfect. Now I want to point out something to you. Jesus said it to Paul like this. My grace is sufficient. I have this amazing Bible program. I have no clue how to use it, but I have this really amazing Bible program. And it tells me all about the Greek language, tells me what the Greek word is, not only what the Greek word is, but the sense of the Greek word, what the root of the Greek word, what the tense of the Greek word is. And so I was looking it up. And as I was reading the commentary here on this Greek word, power is, the author pointed out, Jesus said it in present tense, not past. He didn't say, Paul, my grace was sufficient for you. He didn't say, Paul, my power was sufficient for you. He says, Paul, my grace is and continue and will continue to be and will always be sufficient for you. Paul, my power, my strength is made perfect in the weakness you have today, in the weakness you have tomorrow, in the weakness that you have the next day, in the weakness that you have day after day after day after day. My grace will always be sufficient for you. My power will always be enough for you. Why? Because the insufficiencies that you and I deal with today, we may not deal with them tomorrow, but we might have something else in our way. And God says, despite what you dealt with here, my grace is still sufficient for you. My power is still made perfect in your weakness. And Paul says, I'd rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. That word rest means to tabernacle, to literally the word says to build a tent about me. The Bible says that we're on this pilgrimage to our eternal destination, and these are just tents. And Paul says, I'll boast in my insufficiencies, in my inadequacies, so that Jesus and his grace and his power would literally build a tent around me and provide protection and shelter from the storms of the inadequacies of my life. My wife and I, we're real outdoors people. So we went backpacking with a couple of friends last summer, and I remember we were up in the High Sierras, about 10,000 feet, about 7 miles from the nearest civilization. There was no way to get back. I mean, we were out there, and it was a beautiful day. We were out there sitting in the sun, basking in the sun, hanging out on the side of this beautiful lake, fishing, just hanging out, eating our lunch, and we saw a cloud about 35 miles off in the distance, and we looked at each other. And we said, you know, if there's anything we know about predicting weather in the High Sierras is that you cannot predict the weather in the High Sierras. So we said, let's go back to camp. It was about a 3-mile walk from where we were at to camp. And so by the time we made it to camp, that cloud had come and encapsulated us, and it was fog. It started to drizzle. We had just enough time to get into our tents. And right as we got into our tents, the skies opened. And I mean, if you have ever seen a summer thunderstorm, they are something to behold. But I want to encourage you, if you've ever seen a summer thunderstorm at 10,500 feet, it is something to behold. You cannot help but behold it. Why? The lightning is so strong and so powerful that even with your eyes closed, you see the lightning bolt. The thunder is so strong and so loud, you can't tell where it's coming from. Why? Because you're in it. And there we're in this thunderstorm, and it's lightning and it's raining, and the skies have opened up and it's pouring for about 3.5 hours. And there we just sat in our tent. She got in her little sleeping bag and she pulled out her book and she was reading her book, and I put my headphones in and I took a little nap listening to some music and just had some God time. And for the entire length of that storm, that tent protected us. The little, tiny, minuscule walls of a tent protected us from the elements that were outside that would threaten our trip. You see, Paul says, I'll boast in my infirmities. I'll boast in my inadequacies. Why? That the power of Christ might build a tent around me, that the grace of Christ might cover me, might sustain me in the storms of my inadequacies. When I can't, when the world is screaming at me, I can't, I know that the grace of God is covering me, and I know I can't, but I know He can. So all of a sudden, God starts doing something. We're humble. We come to God and we say, God, I need you. And God starts doing something. And wouldn't you know it, just as God starts doing something in our insufficiencies, in our inadequacies, all of a sudden, pride comes back a-knocking. All of a sudden, I mean, it's not just people in church that I've seen it. In my own life, and though I'm humble and I'm contrite before God, God, fix me, oh Lord. And He says, my grace is sufficient. And I begin to walk in His grace. And all of a sudden, I look back and I start believing my own propaganda. And I think, man, I've got it made. I've made it through it. I have arrived. And I no longer need to go to church as much as I go to church. I no longer need to give. Why? Because my finances are doing better than they've ever done before. I no longer need to pray like I've been praying because God has answered all of my prayers before. And pride starts to step in and creep in. You see, remember I said, let humility bring God's grace to you. Peter says it like this, and James quotes the same Old Testament scripture. Peter says it like this in 1 Peter, the 5th chapter. We know this verse. He's talking to the older people. He says, older people, you know, you older people, you know, surround yourself and work with them. And he says, younger people, don't shut out the older people. You need them. Amen. I believe that with all of my heart. We as generations need to work together. And he says, but all of you, everybody, old and young, y'all got to submit to each other. I love this. And he says, and put on, be clothed with humility. Why? Because God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. You see, we all have inadequacies in life. And the last thing we can do in our inadequacies, the last thing we can afford is the resistance of God in the very areas of our life that we need him. And so we must allow humility to bring God's grace to us. Pride, there's this analogy of a frog. Frogs are cold-blooded animals. And cold-blooded animals, they can't regulate their body temperature. So they adjust their body temperature to whatever the ambient temperature of the air is. That's why oftentimes you'll see lizards and snakes sunning themselves on the day, why, to warm themselves up. We are warm-blooded. So we can regulate our body temperature. How do we regulate our body temperature? By glistening. Like this, right? Got a good little shine. Frogs can't do that. So if you were to take a frog who has been dwelling and living at room temperature and you were to put that frog right over a pot of boiling water, instantly that frog would jump out of the way because he would feel the steam, he would feel the burn, and he would recognize that his body is 78 degrees and not 212 degrees. And instantly he'd move. I think pride's a lot like that. When we see pride in somebody else, we're like that frog over boiling water. Oh my Lord, they are in pride. I'm going to get away. I'm going to resist the devil, for he should flee from them. And I don't even want to be near when the Lord smites them. And we see it. But you see, pride is a lot like that analogy, that if you take that same frog and you put that same frog in room temperature water and you slowly heat that room temperature water up incrementally, a little bit at a time, that frog will regulate its body temperature to the same temperature of the water, to the point where that water temperature becomes deadly. And that frog will never jump out of the boiling pot, and it'll die. Pride is a lot like that. We can see it as clear as day on somebody else. But it is so small. It is so incremental. But yet it is so deadly to our lives, because it is the very vessel that separates us from the grace that we so desperately need to thrive and to sustain life through all of the inadequacies that we have. So church, we must allow humility, the complete reliance of Jesus Christ in our life, to say, God, it's not about me. It's not about my boasting. It's not about my sufficiencies. It's not about my strength. It's not about my wisdom. It's not about my success. It's not about my money. It's not about my friends. It's not about my followers. It's not about any of that. It's all about Jesus. And when we allow humility, when we live in humility, grace comes, and God gives grace to the humble, the grace that saves and the grace that sustains. The grace of God will rest upon us. And when life shouts at you, you can't. You can't. You can't do it. We can look and think like Paul, who had the revelation of grace given to him. Like he says in Philippians, the 4th chapter, verse number 13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. See, he didn't say I could do all things because I'm smart. He didn't say I could do all things because I'm educated. He didn't say I can do all things because I'm wealthy. He didn't say I could do all things because I'm well connected. He said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, because his grace is sufficient for you. His power is made perfect in your weakness. And we are all a bunch of inadequate people, unqualified, insufficient. But yet, when the world says you can't, God says, I can. I can. You can be that father. You can be that husband. You can be that wife. You can be that employer. You can be that Christian. You can be that friend. Not because of your own ability, but because of Jesus Christ and His grace that is sufficient for us. Let's pray together. Father, we come before You, Lord, and we just thank You. Lord, as we walk out of this place, we all know the areas of our lives that we are inadequate. The areas of our life that we just don't seem to measure up, God. The areas that we seem like we'll never be good enough in. We'll never be successful enough in. We'll never be right enough in. Lord, I just pray tonight as we walk out of this place, Lord, that a sense of comfort by the Holy Spirit would rest upon us. Lord, that we would not look at these thorns, that we would not look at these hardships, and that we would not look at these inadequacies of our life and realize and recognize and believe what the world and what everybody else might say against us, or we might even say to ourselves. But Lord, that we would believe what Your word says, that Your grace is sufficient. And Lord, that we can learn from Genesis through Revelation that You called a bunch of inadequate people, and You brought a bunch of inadequate people out of nothing and made them something with Your glory. And Lord, that You chose us when we were nothing to make us something in You. So Lord, as I ask as we walk out of this place that Your church, Your Holy Spirit would begin to minister to us like You ministered to Paul. That You would begin to reveal to us Your grace and Your power and Your might and Your desire for us to become something beyond what we ever thought we could be. The potential that You see in us, Lord, I pray that You would speak that potential to each and every one of us. That we walk out of this place and we know You are going to make us into something because of Your goodness and Your glory. And Lord, when we can't, we will know that You can. And we'll do it through You in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Well, hey, listen, before we leave, I just want to take a quick moment. The Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. And maybe you're looking at your life and you're just saying, man, I am so inadequate, I don't even know where to start. I want to ask you a question. I want you just to examine this question and look into your heart, look into your life, and answer it within your heart. If you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Question's rather simple, but you see, how you arrive at that conclusion has a lot to say about your position and your place with God. Today I want to talk to you about that answer. Oftentimes I hear, when we talk to people and in conversations, I've heard, well, you know what, Pastor Luke, I think I'm going to get to heaven. I hope I'm going to get to heaven. I really want to go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think, that you can hope, that you can want, or you can desire yourself into heaven, and that's enough to get you there? Well, but Pastor Luke, you know what? I was raised in church. My parents brought me up. I was baptized or christened as a child, and I've always called myself a Christian. I go to church on Christmas and on Easter. I'm here tonight. I go on a somewhat regular basis. Doesn't that mean that I'm going to go to heaven? People who go to church go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend church, because your parents gave you a title, that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere in the Word of God will you find that. Well, but I was christened as a baby or baptized. You know, I was confirmed. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because somebody blew smoke and water over you because you made a promise that you couldn't keep, that you're going to make it into heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? You can't get into heaven those ways. Well, but you know what, Pastor Luke, I'm a good person. Good people. You know, I don't cheat on my taxes. I try to give to charitable organizations. I've even done things like buy gifts for other people that didn't deserve it, and I've given to people on the side of the road. I try to live a good life, and I've always believed and I've always lived that if I do good and I be good, if I do good and I am good, it'll all be good. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, because you have good works, because you have good deeds, that you're going to get to heaven? You see, you can't get to heaven because of your good deeds. Why? Because the Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. Nothing we could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. You see, you can't earn it. You can't deserve it. You couldn't buy it. You can't work for it. The only thing you and I can do is accept the gift of God, which the Bible says is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Well, but Pastor Luke, I'm a spiritual person. I have a heightened sense of spirituality. You know, I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything like that. And I always just thought that, like, you know, we all kind of have the same idea and we'll all get to that same area, that same place, whatever you want to call it. You give it your name, I'll give it my name, and we'll all find it the same. Did you know nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you have a heightened sense of spiritual awareness that you're aware that there are things at work that are beyond your understanding or beyond your control? That means that you're going to get into heaven, that you're going to find yourself there one day in that perfect or that aura, whatever it might be. Listen, you're not going to get that. You cannot find that in the Word of God. See, the only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way, and Jesus Christ is that way. In the book of John, in the 3rd chapter, Jesus is speaking to a religious leader by the name of Nicodemus. Jesus says to Nicodemus these words. He says, Nicodemus, in order to see the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. What does that mean, to be born again? You know, we've seen Hollywood and culture and society's made that out to be a mockery. You think of weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. But you know, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. Let me prove it to you. In the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, Jesus is speaking to His church, to people like you and I sitting together, doing the right things, saying the right things, looking the right way. And Jesus says, listen, I'm coming back, I'm returning. And He says, when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot. He says, I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, He says, I'll vomit you from my mouth. I mean, it's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. And what He's saying is, listen, I'd rather find that you're in, or I'd rather find that you're out. Because if I find that you're a little bit in, you know, what is lukewarm? Well, lukewarm is occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. You know, Sunday might be God's day, but Monday through Saturday is your day. He says, listen, if I find that that's you, lukewarm, I will vomit you, reject you out of my mouth. God, forgive us in American churches that we've watered the message down for hundreds of years because we've been more interested in the number of people in chairs than we have been the condition of the hearts of those people. But today, I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough today to tell you the truth, to get in your face, even be offensive if I have to be offensive to you today, which I'm sorry. To tell you the truth that you're not going to make it on your own devices. You're never going to be good enough. You never can hope enough. You never can desire enough. You can't attend church enough and think that a religious service is going to make it be all you need. Because in that same scripture, Jesus says this to His church. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And He says, the invitation is yours. Whoever opens that door says, I will come in and I will dwell with them and I will dine with them and they will be with me and I will be with them and we will be together. You see, I believe right now, right here, the Spirit of God is knocking on the door of your heart, on the door of your life, saying, are you going to answer? Are you going to choose me? Are you going to open the door today? And I want to give you that opportunity to receive and to accept that invitation of Jesus Christ. In just a moment, we're going to pray a prayer of salvation together. We're going to invite Jesus. And in doing so, I want to give you the opportunity. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to do something that Jesus said, not that I said, that Jesus said. Jesus said these words. He said that if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. He says, but if you deny Him, He will deny you. Today, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. And I'm going to smack my hands together real loud. Bang! And when I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to shoot your hand up in the air. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to make a decision to follow Jesus. I feel the Spirit of God knocking on the door of my heart right now, and I want to respond to that. Pastor Luke, that's me you're talking to. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. But if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. I am not here to embarrass you. I'm here to build you. And today it starts by making a decision. Are you going to open the door of your heart, open the door of your life to Jesus Christ? Listen, many of you have been in this place today and you have insufficiencies, inadequacies in your life that you have tried to fill with relationships, with titles, with friends, with finances, with money, with possessions and things. But no matter what you try to do, no matter how much you try to fill those inadequacies, there's nothing that can seem to fill the hole inside of your life. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole that only Jesus Christ can come and fill. And today, the invitation of the Holy Spirit is on your heart right now, saying, come, will you stop doing life your way? And will you start doing it my way? Will you rely on Jesus today? And by making that decision to follow Him, you're making that very first step. Who should raise your hands in this place in just a moment when I count to three? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus, if that's you, just get ready. You pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. If you're not sure tonight, make sure. Listen, you don't have to walk around life hoping and wondering, I hope I'm right, and I really hope so. Listen, the Bible says that God has given us the Holy Spirit on the inside of us as God's seal of approval in us. God wants you to know for sure right now of your position and your place with Him. If you've been living lukewarm, running from God instead of to God, if you've been riding the fence in your relationship with Jesus, come on, it's time to go hot for Jesus and make that decision today. All across this auditorium, from the front to the back, from the side to the side, wherever you're at, if that's you in this place, in just a moment, when I count to three, you pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, you can put it right back down, and we'll pray together right after that. But it starts by making that decision. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. If that's you, this is your moment, this is your time. Listen, you've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now, it's a divine appointment between you and God right now. Will you respond to the calling of Jesus to come home and find life in Him? If that's you, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. You ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Let me see your hands in this place today if that's you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I see that. 8. I see you right over there. 8 wise people. Anybody else on this side over here? 8 wise people. I saw you right there. I saw you over there. 9. I see you right there. Anybody else in this place today? Where are you at? Number 10. I see that hand over there. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should come on. The Spirit of God's calling you, saying, come home. It's your time. It's your turn. Didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Anybody else in this place today? 10 wise people. Well, praise God for 10 wise, wonderful people. Here's what we're going to do. All 10 of you, maybe you're number 11, number 12, number 13, number 14, number 15. You didn't raise your hand, but you should have raised your hand, or you did raise your hand. Listen, I got to tell you, you don't get saved. I said, we're going to pray together. And we're going to do that right now. You don't get saved because you raised your hand in a church service. That's called religion. We're not after that today. You get saved by committing your heart and committing your life to Jesus Christ. And we're going to do that together right here, right now. You're going to act on that decision. The very first thing you do with a decision is you act on it. And now we're going to do that. So in just a moment, I'm going to ask everybody to stand. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Grab somebody if they came with you. Look at them and say, come on, I'll go with you. Or if you brought them, say, come on, let's go together. Will you come with me? And get out of your seat, get out of your chair, and come meet me right here at this altar, because we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand together. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on. You come and you meet me right here, right now. This is your moment. They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. You're worth waiting for. They're still coming. It's time. It's all right. Well, hey guys, you came. You came. Listen, I don't know if anybody's ever told you in your life, but somebody needs to tell you today, good job. Good job. You're doing a good job. You know, you may have a whole life full of inadequacies, but right now, you're doing good. Making the very best decision you possibly can make. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. He's going to do a couple things. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on. I'm as weird as it gets, and you have survived me, all right? He's going to do a couple things. One, he's going to lead you in a prayer. You're going to ask Jesus to be the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior, the leader of your life? You're going to invite Him in your life. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information, some free literature. Why? We want you to leave this place hooked up, right? We don't want you to leave this place wondering, what am I going to do next? We want to set you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. We want to connect you with a friend here. We call them spiritual personal trainers. When you go to the gym, you get a personal trainer. Somebody make sure you're doing all that exercise equipment that's really confusing, right? A spiritual personal trainer is a friend that will meet with you here at church. They'll buy a cup of coffee, get you a soda, some french fries at the cafe if you come on the morning services. Meet with you for just a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God, so that you don't go back to your life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel.